in knowing how graphically you can differentiate between relations and functions. So I have a question for all of you. If you have understood this concept well, I will draw a graph for you. Okay. Let's say the graph looks like this. Okay. Now my question to you is this graph a graph of a relation, or is this graph of a function? Of course, functions are relations only. What is function? Functions are special relations. So will it be a relation, or can it be qualified to call a function as well? That's what my question is. It's not a function? Anirudha, why is it not a function? How do you, let's say I define my domain only from this part, let's say x equal to a to x equal to b. Let's say my domain is all values between a and b. By the way, I'll tell you the meaning of these brackets as well. So many things we have to learn because we have not been introduced to these small things in our class 10. Let's say a and b is your domain. So every element is getting mapped. Yes.
If you draw a vertical line through graph.
Why vertical line? Why not slant line? Why not horizontal line?
Because
why not a line
same
like this?
X value, for the same x value there are multiple y values, which violates the second criteria. Therefore, it's not
absolutely brilliant. Bang on target. What he said, I'll summarize you in simple language. He said that if I draw a vertical line like this. In fact, let me extend this long as well. If I draw a vertical line like this, for a particular value of x, let's say x1, I'm getting multiple outputs. I'm getting multiple answers. y1, y2, y3. That means if I draw an arrow diagram, then there is an element x1 which is mapping simultaneously to. This is not allowed in a function. That means you are putting a toast bread and you are getting three different, you know, responses from the machine on three different days, right? Of course you'll throw off that dabba machine, right? So this will not be a function anymore, and therefore this graph cannot be a graph of a function. Yes, it is a graph of a relation, but that relation is not eligible to be called a function. Understood? Okay. So many such things we'll be learning in this particular course. Okay. So I will start with the graphs of standard function. So function should be treated like machine in your mind, where you put in some input and it gives you some output. So function is like a machine where you put in some input. You can call this as an input, and you get an output for it. This is an output. Okay? And of course now you know that what makes that machine actually a machine, or actually a functional machine. Okay? So what are the two criteria? You are aware of that. Now I'll be telling you the graphs of some standard functions that you will be using throughout your maths. And let me tell you, functions are the basics of all the vertical of maths that you are going to study, whether it's a calculus, whether it's a trigonometry, whether it's algebra. You are going to deal with functions day in and day out. You must also be doing it in computer science, correct? When you write methods in Java, these are all functions, correct? Everything revolves on functions, where you give in some inputs, which we call as the arguments, and it returns some value to you, which is called the output. So this is your output. Whatever you feed is an input. Now you may ask, sir, are functions only meant to take one input? The answer to that is no. There are multivariate functions as well, but that is beyond our scope right now. Okay. Of course, when you do higher engineering, you'll come across multivariate functions. I think in electrostatics, when Felix sir will be talking about potential, potential depends upon the x, y, z coordinates of a body, right? So there you will be dealing with multivariate function. But as of now, to keep things very light for you, since you are just beginning to learn all these things, we'll only talk about single variable functions. Single variable function means you put one input into that only. Can't put multiple inputs at the same time. Okay. So when I talk about standard functions, the very first thing that comes to my mind is a line. Line is also a case of a function, right? It's a linear function, which we call it. Okay. So when I say y is equal to mx plus c, how many of you have come across this expression before? Y equal to mx plus c. This is called the slope-intercept form of the equation of a line. Who doesn't know this? Everybody knows. What is m here?
Slope.
What does slope represent? The gradient of that line. How steep is the line? Right? Can slope be a negative quantity also?
Yes.
When is the negative quantity? Okay. I just to avoid this confusion, because many of you are talking simultaneously. Let's say I decide to move from point A to point B on a line. Correct? Yes or no? How is slope defined, first of all? Slope is defined as a ratio of rise to run. What is rise to run?
How much you move up.
If you move along from A to B, how much you move? Up. Vis-a-vis how much you move? Horizontal. Correct? Rise to run. So if I move from A to B, this would be called my rise, this would be called my run. So this ratio is actually called rise to run. Now where is the scope of it being negative?
If you are going from B to A, I mean how much you are descending as compared.
But if I go, okay, he is saying if I go from B to A, the same line will have a negative slope. And if I am going from A to B, the same line will have a positive slope. Is that what Shreyas is saying? Is it correct? Is it correct?
No, but then...
Does slope of a line depend upon whether you are moving from A to B or B to A?
No, but then it depends on what you are taking your... what you are relating
to. In this case, let's say this is my line. Will my slope change if I go from A to B? Or will it be different if I go from B to A?
It will be negative.
Negative of that? Is he correct? Many of them disagree with you, as I also disagree on that. See, when you say rise by run, if both are positive or if both are negative, m will be positive for sure. Correct? So when you are going from A to B, Shreyas, what is happening? You are going in this direction of y. Anything measured in this direction of y is positive. Anything measured in this direction is negative. You know that. Anything measured in this direction is a positive x, this direction is negative x. So when I am going from A to B, rise is positive, run is also positive. So positive by positive is a positive quantity. If I am going from B to A, rise is negative, run is also negative. So again the ratio is positive. So this line will have a positive slope irrespective of which point to which point you are traveling. Is that fine? That doesn't depend upon the two points you have chosen. But however, if I have a line like this, and this is my point, let's say A, and this is my point, let's say B. So when I go from A to B, is my rise positive?
Yeah, run is negative.
Run is negative. So this ratio will be negative or not? Yes or no? If I go from B to A, rise will be negative, but run will be positive. Again, that ratio will be negative. So such is an example where this line segment, or whatever line that is a part of, would have a negative slope. Understood? So in simple language, anything which is like this is a positive slope. I'm showing it from your angle. Okay? Anything which is like this will have a negative slope. Understood? Correct? So when I say this is a positive slope, if it is lesser, the value will decrease. If it is like this, the value will increase and it can also become infinity when it becomes parallel to the y-axis. Okay. What is C, by the way?
Y-intercept.
What is y-intercept? It's the distance from the origin where the line cuts the y-axis, but this is a directed distance. What is a directed distance? Just like vectors. It also has a positive and negative attached to it. So if it is cutting the y-axis above the origin, C value is positive. For example, if I draw a line like this, and I say this line is passing through 0, comma, minus 3, what is C for this line?
Minus
3, don't say plus 3. If I draw a line like this and I say it is passing through 0, comma, 2, what is C here? Plus 2. Is that fine? So everybody sitting here can draw the equation or can draw the function which is a line. If I give you the m and c value, you will be able to plot it roughly. Yes or no? Okay. Just a small exercise we will do on that. Plot y is equal to negative 2x plus 5. I know all of you know that, but just for, you know, knowing that everybody is on the same page, just draw this. Rough, I don't want you to use scale and all those accurate measurement. Just draw a line, name it at a proper point so that I know that it is passing through this point. Are you sure?
Okay. You're getting it as
where will it cut the y-axis? Mark that point as well. Then, cheers. So it will be basically a line like this, okay, where it will cut the y-axis at 0, comma 5, x-axis will be cut at 5 by 2, comma 0, okay. Please make arrows to signify that this line is extending indefinitely in all the directions. Yes? Acha, such a relation of a line, or such a relation representing a line, is it eligible to be called a function? Correct? Yes or no? Second question is, what do you think is the domain of this function? We talked about domain range, right? What is the domain of this function?
X is equal to R. X is an element of R.
Did anybody understand what he said?
All real numbers.
So for him, he said that the domain of this function is all real numbers. What in the graph tells you the domain of the function? The span of the function along x-axis. Are you getting this point? So from where to where my function is extending along the x-axis, that determines the domain of the function. Understood? So here, I can say domain of this function. Okay, I may write y, sometimes I may write f of x, don't get confused. Last year what happened, they started telling, sir, sometimes you write f of x equal to this and sometimes you write y equal to this. There's no difference. It's because we plot f of x along y axis, we call it y also. Okay. So domain of the function, as Shiv rightly pointed out, would be all real numbers. Now many people say, sir, why do you write this R with a double stroke? Why not a single stroke? Because sooner you will realize when you do the chapter relations, R is also used for writing relations. Relations, just now we talked about relations. So in order to distinguish between two R's, I put a double stroke. In fact, in books also they would do the same. Okay? Just like different people having the same name.
But doesn't it make
In Indian curriculum, if you say R with double stroke, I would take it as a set of all real numbers. But if you just write R like this, I would say, is it a set of relations? An element of doubt may come into your mind. Okay. Anyways. Is this fine? Yes.
So, any line which does not coincide with
now, very good question. If I ask you, plot this line. How do you plot this? What does this say actually? It says that I don't care about That's a very crude way of saying, I don't care about y, x will always be 5. It's a vertical line. And in that case, Shishti, Anjali, this will not be a function. Why? Because for 5 you are plotting to 1 also, 2 also, 3 also, 4 also, 5 also, whatever y you choose, it is all mapped to 5. Are you getting this point? So it will not be qualified to call a function. So all lines need not be functions. Very valid point brought up by Anjali. This may be a function, but not in this case. Okay? But if I say y is equal to 5, how do you plot the graph first of all for it? Yeah, it means I don't care about x. Whatever is your x, my y will be 5. So 1,5, 2,5, 100,5, 0.0025,5. Whatever you choose, the y coordinate will be 5. Will this be a function?
Yes.
No.
Why not?
Y is independent.
Now here comes another misunderstanding. Let's say, hypothetically, I draw a relation for you. Hypothetically, I draw a relation for you which maps set A to set B. Set A is called the pre-image set, set B is called the image set. I have already dictated to you. Let's say, hypothetically, this has got elements A, B, C, and these are elements 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? Answer these questions very, very carefully. Under this relation, let's say A maps to 1, B maps to 3. Is this relation a function?
Yeah.
Sorry, I forgot your name. You are
Pratham. Pratham, yes, Pratham. Is this a function?
Because not all the elements are mapping.
Brilliant. C is not getting mapped. So how can you call this as a function? It is not. Okay? So C is not getting mapped, so it is not a function. It may be a relation, but it is not a function. Chalo, I map C also, but now C is going and mapping to 3. How many of you say it is a function now?
1, 2, 3, 4,
after that I don't know.
Okay, that means rest of you say it is not a function. Or how many of the rest say I don't know actually? How many of you say I'm not sure? Not sure, Ashish? Ashish must be sure what exam you want to write. I'm just kidding. It's actually a function. Now many of you would think that it is not meeting the second criteria. See, second criteria says this fellow cannot go to 2. But two of them come to the same, that is fine. For example, let's say I bought a toaster. Bread number 1, you get an output. Bread number 2, you get a similar looking output. It's fine, right? Yes or no? Let's say bread of one company, bread of another company can give you the same output. Correct? But it should not happen that you're putting a bread and you get a toast one time and you're getting a chapati another time. That will not happen. Okay? So, just to show you the graph, one to many, this is not a function. Now I use the word one to many just to make you understand there's a one here and there are many here. Many to one is a function or can be called a function. Understood? So when I draw a line like this for you, y equal to 5 line, let's say y is equal to 5 line. So if I draw an arrow diagram for it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever you may write it, let's say I write numbers from 1 to 5 only, and here there is a 5, everybody is mapping to 5. So many to one, this is a function. Understood? So it is not violating that unique characteristic. Unique characteristic means one input should give you one output only. Now that output will match with the output of some other input, that is fine. Understood the difference? Understood the difference? Okay. So, a practical example apart from this will be a function like x square. Is this a function in real domain and real codomain? Okay, guys, one very important thing I wanted to tell you. Whenever you mention a function, don't mention it just by stating what is the relation between x and y. Also mention simultaneously where is the function defined. For example, the best way to write this function would be something like this. What does this small statement signify? It signifies that this is a function. You may write y, you may write f of x, that's your call. Don't get confused between y and f of x, they are one and the same thing. Okay, so this is the information about the domain and the codomain, not the range. Remember this. When you mention the function like this, this first set is actually telling you what are the permissible inputs you can put to the function. It's like when I sell a machine to you, I give a user manual along with it, right? So when I sell a toaster to you, I'll write only these items should be put in this toaster. Don't start putting your books and shoes and school bag inside it, even though you hate them, okay? So that user manual as to what you should put in that machine is what? This. Beyond this, you cannot put anything. Remember that. Right? When you buy a car, what does the car manual say? Only to be driven on a surface like road. Can't take it in the water. Correct? What is this information? This is the information about codomain, not the range. Remember that. Many people think, oh, this is domain and this is range. No, that is codomain. Codomain tells you what outputs you can expect from it. What outputs you can expect from that machine, but it doesn't tell you what outputs you can actually get from that machine. Understood the difference? So I gave you an example of the difference between codomain and range. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I wrote that time, right? And I told you, codomain is that entire set. And range is the values which are actually getting mapped. I give you a simple example. This school is like the codomain set. You can go to any room you want. You can. But do you actually go to any room you want? No, you actually end up going to your class, lab, washroom. So class, lab, washroom will constitute your range. But you have been given to access to go, or probably playground also. But you have been given access to go anywhere in this room. Right? You can also enter principal's office. Right? Of course, with our permission. Right? But that's not somewhere where you like to go, right? Unless until you have been called. Yes? So the entire school is your codomain, but the places which you visit is your range. So this tells you where all you are allowed to go. Range is where all you choose to. Understood? Understood the difference now? Whenever you write a function, always write this along with it. Never try to sell a machine without the usual manual. Simple as that. You tell the person that, oh, you are using this function. Only put these values and expect this to come out. Understood? Now, is this function eligible to be called a function? If I put an input 2, what output will I get? If I put minus 2, what will I output I get? So is it violating the condition of the function? Answer is no. Even though both the inputs are giving you the same output, that is fine. That will be called as a many to one function. One to many relation is not a function. Understood now? Will not make a mistake about it. Now many people ask me, is it fine to leave an element of the codomain set unmapped? Yes. But it is not fine to leave an element of the domain set unmapped. If any one of them is left out in this set, then that will be not a function. It's fine to leave out elements here. Understood now? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 will be your codomain. 1, 3 will be your range. A, B, C will be your domain. Yes, sir? Domain. Is that fair? So graph of a straight line is clear to everyone?